Well, the rest of us, let's turn our Bibles to Ephesians chapter 6. And I'll read verse 15. Ephesians chapter 6, verse 15. And having shod your feet with the preparation of the gospel of peace. Now we're looking at the third piece of weaponry here, the Roman soldier's shoes. So Paul takes the shoes of the Roman soldier and he applies it to peace to the believer. So what the shoes does for the Roman soldier, peace does for every believer. And we looked at certain things here. So first of all, I showed you that the Roman soldier's shoes, it provided firmness when he's fighting the enemy there. Secondly, it protected him from the unexpected and surprise attacks of the enemy. Thirdly, it gave him mobility. Fourthly, we looked at the two extremes of the church. And fifthly, we saw the two kinds of peace. You know, one mentioned in Romans chapter 5, verse 1, where Paul says, now having been justified, we have peace with God. He's talking about peace with God. So peace with God is what a believer experiences when they come for salvation to Christ. See, God and man is at enmity. There is a partition between God and man. There's a wall, there's a barrier. Ever since Adam sinned, every single person that is born into this world till today is born in sin. And there's a barrier, there's a wall between God and man. There's an enmity. Man is estranged from God. And therefore man, because he's a sinner and God is a holy God, man cannot even approach God. Forget about coming into his presence and praying and asking and all those things. He cannot approach God. To approach God, you have to be holy. You have to have the very holiness and righteousness of God himself. That is what we see portrayed right through the Old Testament there. So as long as this enmity, this barrier is there, man cannot come before God. That is why you will see in the Garden of Eden, the moment Adam became sin, he couldn't approach God. Even if God was trying to come to him, he was running away. Because that is what sin does here. So when a person first comes to God for salvation, when they come by faith and when they believe what Jesus did for them on the cross there, that Jesus died for them and he was buried and he was raised on the third day, when they believe in the heart and confess with the mouth, then they have been justified. That means all their sins are taken and put upon Jesus on the cross there. And the very righteousness of Jesus is taken and imparted into the believer. He's justified. So what happens when a man is justified? He is at peace with God. That means now that barrier is broken. That wall between God and man, the enmity between God and man is totally dissolved. And not only that, now man is also put in a position where he can avail all the blessings of God. That's the greatest thing about, you know, atoning work of the blood of Jesus. Redemption is a big subject, but one of the most exciting and thrilling subjects is redemption, because it talks about what God has done for us, how he has redeemed us from sin, from slavery, from the dominion of Satan, poverty, and every curse. It's a wonderful story, the story of redemption. So that is what happens when a person comes and believes in Jesus, he's justified. Then that middle wall of partition is broken. The enmity between God and man is dissolved. Now man is at peace with God. Now they are both friends. God is his father. He is child. And when that happens, that's the first thing should happen to every person. Without experiencing or without having peace with God, he cannot experience the peace of God. They are both different. Peace of God is totally different. So a person first must be at peace with God in order to experience the peace of God. And that is what we are looking at. So what is the peace of God? Peace of God is mentioned in Colossians chapter 3:15 and Philippians chapter 4:7. And it is mentioned in other places also. We are coming to that. But before that, I told you that this word peace is a very rich word. You know, the Greek language is a very rich language. For every word, they have four different words there. They don't use the same word. For example, in English, we use one word called love. But in Greek, there are four different words to use different types of love. So it's a very rich language there. And this word peace has different shades of meaning. It is used in the Old Testament, in the book of Isaiah and other places. It is used in the New Testament. Jesus used it in the Gospels. It is also used in the epistles, frequently used by the Apostle Paul, the word grace and peace. Most astounding words, I think, in the epistles. Two beautiful, marvelous words, grace and peace. So this word peace has different shades of meaning. So when it is used in the epistles, it means blessings and prosperity. So whenever Paul uses, he says, grace and peace be with you, he's saying, may blessings and prosperity be with you. That's what he's saying. So it means blessings and prosperity. Then there is another meaning which means, it also means nothing missing, nothing broken. That means your life is satisfied and filled with every good blessing. Nothing missing, nothing broken. You have everything. Completeness, fullness, it means that also. And it also means a calmness, a serenity, a tranquility in the midst of a storm. I mean, you are there in the midst of a storm, but you don't panic, you're not filled with fear. You're just calm, you're quiet, you're cool there, and you're not disturbed or perturbed. You have a peace that passeth all understanding that cannot be explained. It means that also. So it adds different shades of meaning. But here in Ephesians chapter 6 verse 15, the idea that Paul has in his mind, the picture that he has in mind is totally different. When he talks about peace here, he says the peace of God, he's talking about peace as a mighty force. See, people don't look at peace or don't understand peace like this. Yes, it is all of the above. It is blessing, it is prosperity, it is nothing missing, nothing broken. It is all that. It is a quietness and a calmness and a tranquility in the midst of a storm. It is all that. But it is also a prevailing, conquering, dominating, mighty force. Many people don't look at peace like this. They don't understand peace like this. So this is what Paul has in mind. This is the idea and this is the meaning that he's talking about here. So he's talking about the peace of God. What is the peace of God? It's not just blessing and prosperity. It is not just a calmness when you go through troubles and all that. No, it is much more than that. The peace of God, which Paul talks about, which every believer receives and has it with them, this peace that he talks about is something, is a mighty force that will prevail, conquer and dominate every problem. It is able to conquer every problem. It is a force greater than any other force that works against you. That is what he's talking about here when he talks about the peace of God. So that is what it is. The peace of God, what it is? It's not just being calm in the midst of our problems. No, no. It is a mighty force, a prevailing, a conquering force, a force that will conquer every storm and problem, that will prevail over every storm and problem and come out triumphantly and victoriously. That is what peace is. You got to keep that in mind. So the question is this. See, Jesus is such a wonderful person. God is such a wonderful person. I mean, he is a master planner. When you begin to read the Bible and when you begin to understand the Bible, you see how great and wonderful and marvelous is God. And that is why the Bible ascribes him as the only wise God. You know, people may say or talk about other gods, but nobody can be ascribed as wise God. The Bible ascribes God, Jesus Christ, as the only wise God. Says he's the only wise God. Why? Because he plans things ahead. I mean, he doesn't wait for something to happen and then plan. He always plans it way ahead there. So we see here this peace of God. It's called the peace of God because it comes from him to us. He gives it to every believer. The moment a person comes to God, puts his faith in Christ, he's justified, he has peace with God. Now he is a place of position and he also receives the peace of God. This peace that passeth all wisdom, that transcends all human knowledge and understanding there. Every believer has this peace. Jesus gives it to them. He gives it to you. You receive this peace. You have it in you. Everyone has this peace. What is peace? It is a mighty, prevailing, dominating, conquering force. So every person has this within them. That's what peace is. You have this mighty, prevailing, dominating, conquering force or power within you. So Jesus gives it to you when? When you become his child. Now the question is this: why did Jesus give us this peace, something that prevails and dominates and conquers? Why did he give it? Well, that's why I told you he's a master planner. He always knows things ahead. See, he knows very well that you are going to live in this world, and as long as you live in this world, you will face some issues, you will have some problems. He knows it very well. I mean, no one understands this world and the people of this world more better than Jesus himself. He created this world, and he came into this world, and he lived in this world, and he knows this world inside out. He knows people inside out. He knows what they are, everything about them. So no one understands this world and people better than Jesus. So Jesus knows that you will live in this world, and because you're a child of God, there's always a conflict, a confrontation between darkness and light. You have an enemy. The enemy is always trying to do something to you, trying to hinder your blessings, trying to stop your progress, trying to be what God, prevent you from being what God wants you to be in life. Jesus knows this. And that is why the moment you become a child of God, the moment you are justified, the moment you are at peace with God, he gives you this peace, the peace of God. You receive the peace of God. For what? He gives you the peace of God. For this, he gives it to you so that it may guard your mind and your heart, your emotions, your feelings to God and protect you from every work of the enemy. See, even before you could think about the enemy and problems, Jesus already thought about it. Before I could encounter or face any problem in my life, Jesus thought about it. He knew that I will have problems. He knew there is an enemy. The devil hates Jesus, and he will hate everyone that loves Jesus and lives for Jesus and serves Jesus. He's not going to just sit back and, you know, be happy about people who accept Jesus and live for Jesus. No. He's going to go mad at them. He's going to do everything. He's going to try everything to stop them there. And that is why Jesus knows these things. And beforehand, he gives you his peace. The peace of God. For what? So that the peace of God, this prevailing, this mighty, this dominating, conquering force will guard your heart, will guard your mind. It will guard your emotions, your will, and your feelings. That is why he gives you. So as a believer, you have the peace of God. God has given it to you. For what he has given it to you? To guard your heart, to guard the mind, to guard your emotions and your feelings. This is what we're going to look at. So this peace is given to believers to guard them and protect them, especially when you are surrounded by problems, difficulties, and trials. And when you are in grave danger of succumbing to anxious care, worry, and anxiety, that's why it is given. Why it is given? It is given to guard you, protect you, especially when you're in problems and difficulties, when you're anxious about something, when you're worried about something. So this peace, this mighty prevailing force, will guard your heart, will guard your mind, it will guard your emotions and your feelings. It is given to you so that you may take it and tie it extremely tight. I told you the Roman soldier's shoes. It had to be tied extremely tight. So same way, peace. That is what Paul is saying. Having assured your feet with the gospel, with the preparation of peace. He's saying you have to take this peace, the peace of God, which comes from God. You have to take it and bind it or tie it extremely tight around your mind, the emotions and the feelings there. It is something you have to do. I'll show you that. Not only that, it is also given as a defensive and offensive weapon against the attacks of the enemy in their areas of which I just mentioned to you. Where does the devil attack you? Always. He attacks our mind. He attacks our emotions, our feelings. He attacks our thoughts. It is only through this he has access to us. Other than that, he cannot rule and dominate our lives. So he uses all these areas to come to us, to get to us there. And that is why Jesus gives us this peace, so that we are guarded from every attack of the enemy there. Okay, so let's keep all this in mind and go to Colossians 3:15. So every believer has this peace. What is this peace of God? It is a prevailing, dominating, conquering, mighty force. You have it in you. Don't search for it anywhere. It is given to you for what? so that you may take it, tie it around, tightly around your mind, your emotions, your will, so that it will guard your heart, your mind, your feelings and your emotions. It will protect you from every attack of the enemy. That's why it's given to us here. Now with that in mind, come with to Colossians chapter 3 and let us read verse 15. Verse 15. Paul says here, and let the peace of God. See, he's not talking about peace with God. Peace with God is totally different. What is peace with God? It is the dissolving of the enmity between man and God. When a person is justified, that enmity, that middle wall of partition is broken down. Because as long as man is a sinner, he cannot pray, he cannot approach God, he cannot do anything, he cannot come to God. So that has to be settled first. So here he's talking about the peace of God. See, peace with God is different, peace of God is different. A person first has to be at peace with God, then only he can experience or receive the peace of God. So here Paul is talking about the peace of God. And this is what he says, let the peace of God rule in your hearts, to which also you were called in one body, and one body, and be thankful. Now just look at what Paul is saying here. You have received the peace of God. Now what you need to do? What does it say in verse 15? I'm sure you all had your breakfast. What does it say, verse 15? Let the peace of God rule your hearts. Now, I want to ask you a question now. Don't worry if you're right or wrong. Let the peace of God rule your hearts. Who have to do it? Does God have to do it or you have to do it? See, some people, especially Christian people, I think they are lazy people, some of them. They have this idea that God will do everything for them. They think God will do everything. You know, in Tamil they say, Ella oru pathu paar, onrukku avana kedaiyadhu. I'm sorry, my friend, God will not do everything for you. There are certain things you have to do for yourself. Hello? You know, sometimes young people, especially when the question of marriage comes, so when they're at the right age to get married, you know, there's an appropriate age, a right age to get married, and then you ask them, when are you getting married, or why aren't you still married? You know what they say? Well, God will show me the right boy, brother. God will take care of that. He will do this. So I'll tell some people, straight you'll have to go for the 60th year marriage, I think. See, they think everything God will do. No, my friend, God will not do everything for you. There are certain things that you and me have to do. For example, God gives you anything, you have to receive it, isn't it? You have to do it. You have to receive it. If I take something and give it to you, you don't put your hand like this. No, you say thank you and you receive it. You have to do something. You have to receive it. So people have this vague idea that God will do everything. He will take care of everything. I don't have to worry about children. Don't have to worry about the studies. Don't have to think about anything. He will do everything. No, my friend, God gave you children. You better take care of the children. God will not pay their fees. You pay their fees. That's why he put you as a mother and father. You provide for them. You buy them clothes. You educate them. You get them married. Until they are big enough to go and earn money. So that is what Paul is saying here. God gives us the peace. We receive the peace of God. He gives it to us. But then what should we do with this peace? See, a lot of people, they receive a lot of things. They receive new life. They receive all the power. They receive wisdom. They have the knowledge. Christ has become wisdom unto us. He is our wisdom. As a Christian, you don't lack wisdom. You don't lack knowledge. You have everything that it takes, my friend. Everything that is in Christ is in us. We have all the power, all the wisdom, all the favor, all the anointing, all the power, every single thing we have within us. The problem with Christian people is they don't know what they possess in them. That's the problem. Everything is deposited. They've received it and they've deposited inside, safely kept there, not used. Now, my friend, God gives you things to be used. Money is not to be tied up in sacks and put in the bathroom walls. No, it is to be used. God gives it to you, blesses it for what? To use it, to enjoy it. Don't take it and, put it up in the sack and, put it in the wall, bury it in the wall. Why? Because you're afraid someone will come and take it away. So what is the use of having so much money when you cannot even sleep properly? You're afraid of someone coming and stealing it. That's why you're putting it in the walls and burying it underground. Things are to be used there. So in the same way, the peace of God, God gives you the peace. We receive the peace of God. But then you have to do something with the peace of God. You just don't receive it and keep it like that. You have to take this peace of God and you have to bind it around your mind, your will, your emotions and your feelings. And that is what Paul is saying here. He says, let the peace of God. Let means it is something that you have to do. God will not come and take this peace that he has given you and bind it around your mind and your will and emotions. No. He says, you do it. I've given you this peace. What is this peace? This is a prevailing, conquering, dominating, a mighty force. I have given it to you. For what I have given to you? I have given it to you so that it will prevail against the problems that you face in life. That's why I have given it to you. It will guard you. It will protect you from the enemy. It will cause you to conquer the enemy because the enemy will attack you in these areas of your life. And that is why I am giving it to you. So you got to take this peace and you got to let it dominate your whole being. That is why he begins it like that. He says, let the peace of God. Let means after receiving it, you got to let it flow into every aspect of your life. It is the same with love and grace and anointing and everything else. You receive it, but then you got to let it flow through every part of your being. So that is what he's saying here. Let the peace of God rule your hearts. This word rule is a very interesting word. Here it means, when he says, let the peace of God rule in your hearts, it means here, dominate, control, govern your heart and mind. I like the way Paul chooses his words. Amazing. He knows what he's talking about. And the words that he chooses are so precise. He says, let the peace of God rule. What is rule? Rule means dominating, controlling, or govern. So he says, let peace dominate, control, and govern. Govern what? Your mind, your emotions, and your feelings. This prevailing force that we all receive from God, it comes from God. We receive it. After receiving it, we must learn how to let it dominate our minds, our emotions, and our feelings. We need to do that. So that is what he's saying here. Let the peace means, it means control, dominate, govern the heart and mind. I think it's come out more better in the Amplified version. The Amplified version says, let the peace, soul harmony, that means the harmony of the soul, the harmony of the mind. It's talking about a mind that is in total control, not disrupt. See, when a person is worried, the mind cannot think properly, cannot think clearly. There's always confusion and chaos. The mind is disrupted. Thoughts are disrupted. They don't know what to do. They can't make any decisions. That is what here it's talking about. That's why I think the Amplified is a very precise translation. So it says, let the peace, the soul harmony, which comes from Christ's rule, act as an umpire continually in your hearts, deciding and settling with finality all questions that arise in your minds. But don't worry, if you don't have an Amplified version, you can go to the net and check it out, and your phone, you can download and read it. But I'll explain what this means here. Here, a new word is introduced, not the new word, the right translation is introduced in the Amplified, the word umpire. Because that is the idea that the Apostle Paul has in mind. When he uses this word rule, This is the picture he has in mind. He has the picture of an umpire or a referee. Okay, so that is what the Amplified is saying here. Let the peace, soul-stirring, soul harmony, which comes from Christ, act as an umpire continually in your hearts, deciding and settling with finality all questions that arise in your minds. And it goes on, but I'll just stay with that with the translation, because that is sufficient for our interpretation here. So in Colossians chapter 3, verse 15, if you want to really understand what Paul is saying here, you have to understand that word rule. So rule means dominating, control, it means governing. And this word is actually taken from a Greek word used to portray the umpire or referee who judged the athlete games in ancient times. Even now, they are the ones who judge the games and sports. See, Paul was very familiar, and when he used the word rule, everybody understood what Paul was saying, because he was taking something that was very familiar of his day, the ancient sports or the games there, and he took that event and he was explaining a truth. So everybody understood. Nobody had any problem in what he said. Only we have a problem, because we need to go back, to that time and see in what context and what background Paul used this word. That is why sometimes we have an difficulty in understanding this. So Paul takes this word rule. It comes from a Greek word which portrayed the umpire or the referee who judged the athletic games in ancient world. And even today, they are the ones who judge the games or sports. So by using this illustration, Paul is saying here that just like the umpire or referee calling the shots and who judge, who rule, who make the decisions in the games. I need to explain this a little. Now you take cricket. In cricket, you are an umpire standing there. And he's the one who's ruling the game. He's the one who's calling the shots. He's the one who is judging what is right, what is wrong. So we have there an umpire standing, and let's say a bowler is coming to bowl there, and he oversteps the crease there. And immediately what the umpire does there, he calls out a no ball. He says, well, no ball. So what is he doing? He's calling the shots. He's ruling. He's acting as a judge there. He's seeing what is right and what is wrong. He's judging. He's making the decisions there. So he says it's a no ball. You have to bowl it again. The next time if you bowl wide, he says it's a wide ball. Somebody is out, he declares out. Okay, so he is acting as a judge. He is in total control. He is calling the shots. He is making all the decisions there. Now let's say the bowler is coming there to bowl. He's stepping over the crease. The umpire is here and there's a fielder there. And the fielder is looking at the bowler and the bowler is overstepping the crease. Can the fielder now shout no ball? Can he declare? No, he has no right to declare. A fielder cannot do that. Only the umpire to do that. That is why he is there. He is there to control the game. He is there to judge the game. He is there to call the shots. He is there to declare what is right, what is wrong. He is there governing. He is the one who has sole authority in making decisions. Now a player, maximum that he can do is he can appeal. If he sees something and if he thinks he is right, he can only appeal. But he has no right to make any decisions. Only the umpire or the referee has all the right to make decisions, whether in games or sports. If they say something, that is settled, finished. You cannot argue with him. You cannot fight with him. If you argue with him, you'll be penalized there. You'll even be thrown out from the team. You'll face consequences. His word is final. So Paul, when he's using this word rule, he takes this word that was used in Greek sports and games there. People understood it very well. So he's referring to an umpire or a referee there. And he's saying here, just like how in games and sports, the umpire or the referee there, they are the one calling out the shots. They are the one who is judging what is right and wrong. They are the one that is making the decisions. Paul is saying here, same manner, Christian believers, we need to allow the peace of God to fill our hearts, our minds, our emotions, and our feelings. Why? so that the peace of God may rule and control and dominate and govern our lives. And he's saying, when he says, let the peace of God rule in your hearts, in other words, he's saying, let the peace of God, this dominating, this controlling, this mighty prevailing force, call the shots in your life. Make the decisions of your life. That's what he's saying here. I'll explain it later, a little more simpler, make it more simpler. But this is what he's saying. Just like how the umpire, he's the one calling the shots. He's the one ruling, declaring everything, making decisions. He doesn't allow anyone to make decisions. He is the one who has the right to make decisions. In the same way, believers have to allow the peace of God that their minds and hearts are filled with to make decisions in their life. The peace of God should call the shots. The peace of God should call the decisions, make decisions. In other words, your heart, mind, emotions, and will must be so dominated that must control you and dominate you. That must make decisions in your life. And you should never allow the problems to speak to you and to make decisions for you, to govern you and to dominate you. That's what he's saying here. You are the one who's to make decisions. You must call the shots. That means you speak to the problems. You have dominion over the problem. Are you getting it? You don't allow the problem to speak to you. You are the umpire. You are the referee. The umpire and the referee, what he does, he calls the shots. He makes decisions. He doesn't allow the players to make decisions. In the same manner, he's saying, believers need to allow the peace of God to make decisions. Problems should not speak to your mind. They should not govern your mind. They should not dominate your mind. They should not dominate your will and your emotions and your feelings. Because once they dominate, then problems will speak to you and problems will make you decide things. So you don't allow problems to rule and govern and dominate and make you do things. No, you don't listen to problems. You don't allow problems to rule and govern and dominate your life. Rather, you allow the peace of God to rule your mind. That's what he's saying here. Don't let cares and anxieties and worries and problems dominate your mind and your feelings and your emotions. Because once you allow that to dominate your mind, then finished. They will control you. And all your decisions will be as a result of that. You know, this is how the enemy attacks us. He attacks our mind. I told you, he's very famous for playing mind games. In our previous studies, we looked at that. How he always attacks the mind, appeals to the mind. He appeals to our will, our emotions, our feelings. See, the mind, the will, the emotion, and the feelings are all wonderful gifts that God has given to man. Man is the only one that possesses all these things because he is like God. So the enemy doesn't like this. So these are the ways that he tries to appeal to us. He appeals to the mind. He appeals to our will. He appeals to our affections and emotions. Why? So that he can rule in our minds and our wills and our emotions and our feelings. He can dominate. He can control. And he can force his decisions through us. See, the moment he dominates your will, finish. You don't decide anything. He makes you decide things. How do you know whether you're dominated by problems? Simple test. You can apply to yourself. Let's say you're having a financial crisis. I mean, really broke, desperate for money. What do you do? Or what do? Immediately we go to someone and we ask, isn't it? Hello? I think I'm the only one like that. So what that tells us, it tells us nothing else but the problem. See, we have a problem. What the problem? It's a financial problem. I'm just using finances because everybody understands that. We have a financial problem. We are so focused upon the problem. Now the problem has spoken to our minds. It has dominated the mind, dominated our will, dominated our emotions and our feelings. And that is why now what we do? we choose to ask or borrow or do something other than waiting and trusting for God for it. Simple. See, your actions will tell you what you are governed by and dominated by. I've been listening to the problem. I've been allowing the problem to dominate my mind, dominate my emotions, my will and my feelings. And that is why now my actions are governed by Satan or by the devil. So that is what Paul is saying here. Don't let worry, anxiety, or the cares of this world or problems dominate your mind, your will, your emotions and your feelings. Because the moment it begins to dominate your mind, emotions, will and feelings, then finish, you are defeated. He begins to force his decisions through you. He enforces his will. He doesn't allow your will to function. He forces his will through you. He makes you do what he wants you to do. Turn with me to Matthew chapter 6 for a moment. Matthew chapter 6. You can read, it goes on from verse 25 to 34. But I'm not going to read all the verses. Just going to read one verse, verse 25. Matthew chapter 6, verse 25. Therefore I say to you, do not worry about your life, or what you will eat, or what you will drink, nor about your body, what you will put on. Is not life more than food, and the body more than clothing? I'll just stay with verse 25. But you can go home and read from verse 25 to 34. Now, if you read from 25 to 34, you will find out in these verses that the word worry, King James here has the word worry, other translations use the word anxious. So Jesus says here, don't worry about your life. Hello? He says, don't worry about your life, about what you should eat, what you should wear, and what you should drink. But I'm going to show you that is exactly what we are worried about every day. Every day, what to eat, what to drink, what to wear. We are worried about food, about money, about clothing, about how to pay the fees, about how to pay the rent, about how to pay our phone bills. You know, today we have more bills than anything else. If you write all your bills, you know, the list is endless. It seems to go on and on. For everything, it's a bill, monthly bill we have to pay nowadays. Life is full of bills. So if you read these verses from 25 to 34, you'll find that the word worry or the word anxious occurs at least 6 times. Now, when something is repeated, when a word or a phrase or a sentence is repeated, it's repeated not for the sake of repetition. It is repeated because the author of that book wants you to pay attention to something important that he is saying there. So if something is repeated twice, that means it is important. Pay attention. So if you missed it the first time, so when you read it the second time, at least you'll understand it. But here it is repeated 6 times. 6 times. Why so many times? Because it is so, so important for you and me to understand, not to worry about these things, about our lives. That is what Jesus is saying here. Don't worry about your life, what you will eat, what you will drink, what you will wear. Don't worry about it. Now my question is this. First of all, this was spoken 2,000 years ago, isn't it? If you have a good Bible, it's in red. These are the words of Jesus, the teachings of Jesus from the Sermon on the Mount, one of the greatest teachings of Jesus, 2,000 years ago. Now the question is this, was whom he speaking this, or was whom he telling this to? Who was he telling, don't worry, don't be anxious about your life? Was he speaking to unbelievers, ungodly people? Now I need the answer from you. No, then who was he speaking it to? He was speaking to his disciples. Isn't that? To his disciples. 6 times he was telling his disciples, don't worry, don't be anxious, don't worry, don't be anxious. Don't worry about your life. Don't worry about all these things, about food and clothing and money and all. Don't worry about it. Why? Because the disciples were worrying exactly about that only. 2,000 years have come and gone, and I tell you, you and me are the same yesterday, today, and forever. Believers all over the world are the same. They do exactly opposite of what Jesus says. Can you imagine? 2,000 years before Jesus said this, don't worry about your life. Because he goes on to explain, don't worry about food, about clothing, about eating. Don't worry about all this. Why? Because your heavenly Father knows that you have need of all these things. Hello, he is a creator of God. He is the one who created you and me, my friend. And if you read the first chapter of Genesis, you will find out that even before he could create you and me, he created whatever we need in life there and put it there in abundance for us, and then only created you and me. You got to learn from the first chapter of Genesis. He didn't stop with just saying, don't worry. He didn't say, don't worry, everything will be okay. No, he says, don't worry. Why don't worry? Because your heavenly Father, you are his child, he's your father, and he knows that you have need of all these things. How many of you are parents here? You have children, isn't it? You know very well that your children needs food. Hello? Somebody has to remind you about giving food to your children. You have not fed your child for 3 days. Please give him some food. Hello? Somebody has to remind you to buy clothes for your children. No, my friend. You know, as a father and mother, it is your duty. You know when your child is hungry. You know he needs food, he needs clothes. You don't wait for his pants and shirts all to wear and tear away and then go and buy a new one. No. You always buy more. You buy him the best with what you can, isn't it? That is what he's reminding them of there. Not simply saying, don't worry. Don't worry. Why? Because your heavenly Father knows that you have need of all these things. He created you. He brought you into this world. You are not here because of your choice. You did not choose to come into this world. You were not chosen to be born into this world. No. God has chosen you. God brought you into this world. You are a miracle of God. He brought you into this world. Why? Because he has a plan and a purpose, and he will provide for you. That is why he says, don't worry. I mean, 6 times he tells his disciples, don't worry, don't worry, don't worry. Don't be anxious about anything of these things for life, about your life. 2,000 years have come and gone. And we are the same yesterday, today, forever. We always do exactly opposite of what he says. He says, don't worry means we worry. I think that is human psychology, I think. You know, when a child takes a pencil and writes on the wall or scribbles on the wall, and you beat that child and you say, don't write, child gets more angry and begins to scribble more. Human psychology. So you don't say, don't do. You just divert the attention of the child. You do something else. So even today, believers all over the world do exactly opposite of what he says. We worry, we care, our life is full of anxieties, and we allow the worry and the care and the anxieties and the problems to govern our mind, feelings, emotions. That's what we do. See, we not only worry, we worry. And we allow this worry to dominate our mind, our will, our feelings, and our emotions. And once you do that, once you allow worries and anxieties and the cares of this world and the cares of life to rule, to govern, to dominate your life, then you know what happens. You are like a madman or a madwoman. I mean, you will be tossed to and fro just like that. By the enemy. And people are like that. They cannot think straight. They cannot think clear. They cannot make proper decisions. They often say, well, I'm like a madman. I'm like a madwoman. Unable to think straight. Unable to make the right decision. This decision. I don't know what to do at this time. What has happened? You have allowed worry, you have allowed the problems, the anxieties of life to dominate the mind, to control your mind, your will and your emotions. And that is why now that is speaking and that is using you, that is dominating you. See how often we allow worries, different, whether it is finances or sickness, whatever, for different people it is different things. We all have our own problems. But the thing is this, we allow problems to dominate us, to control us, to govern our lives, instead of we dominating problems, controlling problems. That is what he's talking about here. And Paul says, let the peace of God rule your hearts. In other words, he's saying, instead of you listening to the problem, you don't listen to the problem. You don't allow the problem to rule and to govern you and dominate you. No, you don't do a thing. Just like the umpire and the referee, he doesn't allow the players to do something, to speak there, to rule and to govern. No, he is the one there. He is acting as a judge there. He is the umpire. He is the referee. He has the right. He has the authority to call the shots. He is the one who's making decisions. In the same manner, Paul says, let the peace of God that is ruling your heart and your mind and your will and your emotions, let the peace of God call the shots and make the decisions. Don't allow problems to rule and govern and make decisions through your life. That is what he's saying here. You know, I often say this. Christian people are very good people. They're so good that they will give ear to the problem. They will listen to problem and they will believe the problem. And they will just, you know, carry the problem anywhere and talk about the problem there than to do what the word of God says. Hello? Have you seen people with problems? I mean, they're so dominated by it, so controlled and governed by it, that wherever they go, they tell their problems. You know, before they used to have something called the women's meeting, you know, some of the things we don't do here, because we learned many things from that. Thank God we learned. We had some wonderful experiences, have rich experience. That, you know, they have this thing called women's meeting. All the women folk, please come and we'll fast and we'll pray. Pray for the family, pray for the church and pray for the nation. And they'll all come and everyone will fast and pray. And they'll pray for the church and for the pastor and for each one and the family and everything they'll do. Everything will start off fine. And as the days go by, you know, one woman will say, well, please pray for my husband because he's a drunkard. And they'll say, okay, all, let us pray. Now 50 people are praying. And after praying, you know what, 49 people, they'll go and tell everyone, you know, that person, woman, that lady's husband is a drunkard. We prayed, so you also pray. Everybody prayed, and the whole world is praying. Everyone knows that person's husband, that wife's, that husband is a drunkard. This is what happens. Then after that, it's no prayer. It's about talking about each other's husbands only and other people. I mean, they're so dominated by the problem. They allow the problem to control, rule, and govern that they cannot be without speaking it. Everywhere they go, they tell it. I know one lady who literally did it. Her husband had a drinking issue. And she just went and told every Tom, Dick, and Harry. Now everyone knew that this man is a drunkard now. And that made him more angry. So this is what Paul is saying here. See, you can know by your actions what is dominating you. Whether you are dominated by this prevailing peace of God, or you are dominated by the problems of God. By your actions, you can say. So that is what Paul is saying here. Let the peace of God rule in your hearts. God has given you this peace for what? To guard your heart, to guard your mind, to guard your will and your emotions. From what? From the enemy. Don't allow the enemy, because once you allow him, he will dominate the mind, he will dominate the will, and he will use it for his purposes. He will control you. He will make decisions for you. You will not make decisions. He will make you and force you to make decisions that you may not even want to make in life. So that is what Paul is saying. Let the peace of God rule your hearts and minds. That means let the peace of God act as an umpire and referee. Let the peace call the shots. I mean, you speak to your problems, my friend. You don't hear what the problems say to you. People love that. They love to hear what the problems say. Now, when people come with problems, sometimes I take scriptures, I counsel them, and I do everything, and they will say, oh, yes, yes, amen, amen. And after that, again, they will talk about the same old problem. I mean, so dominated, so controlled by these things. You are allowing the enemy to make decisions for you. He's dominated your mind, the will, your emotions, your feelings, and that is why now he's making decisions. He's telling you what to do. You don't do what the Word of God says. So instead of worrying about life, about what you need to eat and, you know, what you need to wear and about money and all these things, instead of worrying about it, he's saying here, let the peace of God rule your hearts. Let it govern your heart and mind. Why? It'll guard you and protect you against the enemy. The enemy will never be able to dominate you and force his decisions through you, never. That's what he's saying here. Let the peace of God act as an umpire, making decisions. See, the umpire is the one who makes decisions. He calls the shots. In the same way, the peace of God that is ruling your mind, that should make decisions. Your mind, the peace of God should call the shots. Your mind and feelings and emotions should be ruled by the peace of God. Okay, I think, why we allow problems to dominate us, rule us, and govern us is because, one is, we never have a revelation about the peace of God. We never understood that the peace of God serves not only as a defensive and offensive weapon, but the peace of God is a mighty, prevailing, conquering force that is in us. We fail to understand that. If we only understood that the peace of God will guard us and protect us, and it is a mighty, prevailing, conquering force, then I tell you, we will not allow problems to dominate and control us. So one thing is, we fail to understand the peace of God and what it is. And the other thing is, we fail to understand problems also. See, you should understand everything in the right perspective. You should have a right understanding about the peace of God, a right revelation about that. And you should also understand problems. See, I think one of the reasons why people are dominated by problems and controlled by problems and get crazy because of problems is because they don't understand problems. I mean, as long as everything is going well, they are fine. But the moment they have a small problem, they allow it to rule and govern and control them and drive them crazy in life. Why? Because they don't understand problems. You need to have a right perspective of problems, my friend. So I'll give you an example, an illustration that will remind you when you go through problems so that you'll not panic. You'll not get crazy. Well, every one of you have a washing machine at home? Yes? Some wives are telling the husbands we don't have. So if you don't have, make him go and get one. No, some husbands are very tight. They don't want to pull out the money from there. So I say, well, give him the clothes to wash every day. Then you'll get the washing machine immediately. So every one of you have a washing machine, at least you understand how it functions. So let me use this illustration to help you understand problems so that when you go through the storms of life, you will not go crazy. You will know what you are going through. Yeah, you'll know what you're in and you'll know the end result of that also. A simple illustration. See, that's why I say you can learn from everyday affairs of life. So problems are like a washing machine. They twist you, they agitate you, they turn and spin you around. But in the end, you come out cleaner, brighter, and better. Now this is how a washing machine was designed It is designed to function like this only. So problems also are designed to function like this. So you take your clothes and you go put it in the washing machine there, and you just press a button there. It fills the water, it takes the soap, and then what happens? You know, it soaks there for some time. Then the clothes are agitated, twisted, turned around, spinned, dried out. And finally, the clothes come out how? Comes out cleaner, better, and brighter, isn't it? Am I right? Well, if you go abroad, you just have to take some money or coin there and put it in that machine and put your clothes there. It not only washes and cleans it and dries it, but even irons it out and comes out. Comes out much better. Now I want to ask you a question. While the clothes are in the washing machine, are they crying out? Are they saying, oh, I'm drowning in this washing machine, somebody put me here and lock me up? Is the clothes screaming? I'm being agitated? I'm being turned around? I'm twisted? Hello? Does the clothes shout? No, it doesn't shout. It knows it'll come out cleaner, better, and, you know, brighter. But Christian people don't understand problems. When they face problems, this is what they're doing. They're crying out and shouting as if they're drowning in the problems. I mean, they're allowing the problems to dominate and control them and drive them crazy. They think they're going to be immersed in the problem. They're going to be, you know, turned around, drowned in the problem. They're just going to sink in the problems. That is why they act and behave like this. Well, you should know something about problems, my friend. You'll always come out better and brighter. Problems cannot do anything to you. I always say a Christian person is like a football. You take a football and you take it down into the swimming pool there in the water and you leave it there, what will happen? It'll come up faster than you. Before you can come up, the ball comes up there. So Christian is like that. Problems cannot drown you. You know, it may agitate you, may twist you a little, may shake you up a little, may try to turn you around, but don't worry, don't panic, don't fear, don't allow it to dominate you. Know one thing for sure, that the peace that is within you will prevail over these things. You may be in the midst of a storm, but you have the peace of God. And why it is given? It is given so that when you are in the midst of a storm, this peace here that is a mighty force will prevail, will conquer, and will bring you out victoriously. Amen. So don't fear problems. Don't listen to problems. When it speaks to you, tell it to shut up. When you have lack and want and the enemy speaks, tell him to shut up. Don't listen to the enemy. Don't listen to what the problem says. Don't allow the problem to dominate your mind and your will and emotions. No, no. Let the peace of God dominate your mind, your will and emotions. Well, so long I'm talking about problems and how not to worry, but the question is this. Because in Matthew chapter 6, it says don't worry there. Then in Philippians chapter 4, verse 6, Paul says don't worry or don't be anxious there. But this is our problem. What is our problem? Our problem is we don't know how not to worry and how to let the peace of God guard and protect our hearts and minds. That's our problem. We know that peace is a mighty, conquering, dominating, prevailing force in us. We have it. We know that. But the thing is, we don't know how not to worry and how to let the peace of God rule our hearts and minds and will and emotions. We don't know that. If we only knew that, then I tell you, you will conquer every problem that comes against you. Problems will not drive you crazy. It'll only make you a better person. Amen. Every problem you face, every challenge you face will make you a better person. So the more problems, more challenges, you get better and better and better. So next week we're going to talk about that. Paul in Philippians chapter 4, verse 6 and 7, he talks about the solution there. He talks about how not to worry. He says don't be anxious there. How not to worry and how to let the peace of God guard and protect our hearts, our minds, our will, our emotions. How to take peace and bind it around us so that it'll be a prevailing and conquering force against the enemy. That is what he talks about in Philippians chapter 4, verse 6 and 7. So next week I'm going to talk about how not to worry. Because so I'm just telling you, not don't worry, but that's not enough. How not to worry. And how to let the peace of God rule my heart, our minds, our wills, our emotions. Next week we will talk about it. Shall we all stand?